I was touring the country as an aftermath of the Exxon Valdez oil spill. And one of the lessons for us had been, how did corporations get this big, where they can manipulate the legal system, the political system, and turn it against us, we the people? And so I was on tour in America giving talks at universities. And here I read the paper on April 21st, 2010, and it's the Gulf blowout. And I thought, nope, I can't do that again. And I didn't even look past the picture. I just went, I can't do that again. It was such an emotional drain. And it took me about a week of touring before I realized, I came out of the me, and I realized we, our community, learned a lot in the 20 years that we had to deal with Exxon. We learned about all the lies. We learned that really it was all up to us. We had to take care of ourselves. We made a lot of mistakes. And I realized that all the communities in the Gulf were going to make the same mistakes. So I thought, that's it. Maybe I can save help people from making the same mistakes we made. Maybe I can help people from getting sick like we did. And so before I lost my nerve, I booked a one-way ticket. And I was in Denver at the time. And I literally flew down without knowing a soul on May 3rd. Took a day to regroup, got a rental car, and headed down to Venice. And as I was checking in at the hotel, the woman behind the counter said, Alaska, what are you doing here from Alaska? And I just looked at her and I said, I'm an Exxon Valdez survivor. I'm a commercial fisherman. And she goes, I'm a commercial fisherman too. What do you want? And I said, I want to talk to the fisherman. And 4.5 hours later, I was sitting at the Riverside Cafe with 40 people. And they were telling me what was going on. And I was reading out of my book the exact same things that happened 22 years earlier to us in Alaska. I just started with like this spiel of what had happened to us, where Exxon had come into our high school gym and said, we will make you whole, 4 days after the Exxon Valdez disaster. And we were naive enough to believe them. And then as this whole thing unfolded, it turned out Exxon didn't even know what we lost. I mean, we will make you whole? Really? What is the price for a shattered marriage? What's the price for a suicide, for someone's life? I mean, those things are not compensable, we learned. So I was talking about how there's economic damages, but there's also quality of life, culture, things that the U.S. court won't even consider, and people's health. And when I started talking about health, people wanted to know what had happened. And so I started talking, well, actually, I didn't start. I said health, we got sick. And people said, my husband or my son, they have a headache. They have, their eyes are watering, their throat's sore. And I just looked at them and I opened my book and I started reading those exact same symptoms from Exxon Valdez, the workers. You know, there was kind of a progression. What I did was I rented a car and I just went across the Gulf, back and forth, back and forth. And I would try to address the community's needs as their awareness built of what was happening to them. And so initially, like in May, pretty much the concerns were about the people who were out on the in-situ burn team, the fishermen who were out in harm's way, really, burning the oil, breathing the oil, and they had hard hats instead of respirators. And that was exactly what happened to us in Alaska. And the workers were also trained only 4 hours instead of 40 hours for a hazardous waste training. And that didn't change either. And 4 hours is not enough time to adequately train workers. And so workers were getting sick. And that was the initial concern. But then by, I would say, towards the end of May, the oil and the dispersant already had started coming ashore in levels where people were noticing it consistently. And as I drove back and forth, more and more people at these Gulf, at these community gatherings were saying, well, you know, I've got this scratchy throat, or I had a nosebleed or an ear bleed, and they would find, you know, how many other people in the audience, I would say, raise your hand, and then they'd kind of look around and, oh, it's more than just me. And so people were starting to question the air quality, the water quality. So then people looked at EPA for answers, looked to EPA, and EPA was doing air quality monitoring. But the problem was twofold. One, in Alaska, on our beaches, We have sea lions, seabirds, sea otters. We don't have 4 to 5 million people packed right up on the beaches all the way across the Gulf. So there was a whole public health element that was new for me. But I realized it would affect the people the same way as the oil would affect the people the same way as it did the workers. The workers are just sort of like the canary in the coal mine. But if you expose people to a lesser level over a longer time, they'll get just as sick as the workers. So it was like a nightmare when I was back down here, because it turns out British Petroleum was using the exact same chemical dispersants, Corexit, that Exxon used 22 years earlier. And we had researched these products 22 years ago and found them to be horribly toxic, not only in and of themselves, but to people as well, not just to the wildlife. Corexit 9527, for example, has a known human health hazard called 2-butoxyethanol that lyses or breaks down blood cells. And the test with the Exxon Valdez is the cleanup crews that were spraying Corexit 9527, they had to have urine tests every night when they came back in. And if they were peeing blood, then they were pulled. Well, that's too late. They were overexposed. And in their intervening 22 years, I mean, some of the sickest people that I've dealt with have been the workers who sprayed Corexit products. And here we are down in the Gulf with exactly these same products again. And so I was trying to warn people that, oh my God, you know, this is like a nightmare. So people are describing to me how odd things are happening. They go wading on the beach when they could not see any visible oil, so they thought it was safe, but their skin burned like it had invisible jellyfish stinging them. And then they went home and took a shower. It didn't matter. The next day they were burning, and their skin would have these big rashes and bumps all over it that it turns out a lot of these people still have to this day. So we're talking now 9 months later. Some of these alleged, what the doctors down here are calling just a skin rash, are actually not responding at all to antibiotics, which means to me that they're not bacterial in origin. It's probably chemical. So I think we have a whole another problem down here that's related to dispersants. The choice of product, cleanup product, Corexit dispersants, magnified by that these products are solvents that will act like an oil transportation system, an oil delivery system. It'll take the oil right on through your skin and create an even worse problem.